Warmly welcome all of you to my YouTube channel, and through this video we are going to discuss about very special part regarding to the O-level syllabus, that is the adjustments for financial statement lesson. I think this is the most important lesson to our grade level students, so this video will help you to expand your knowledge regarding to this adjustment part. And not to forget to subscribe my YouTube channel as well as click on the bell icon, then it's helpful to take the coming videos easily, and then you will be able to join with us continuously. So okay, let's go to the presentation and check step by step how this adjustment lesson is going to be applied for the financial statement parts. Okay, let's start the work. This lesson is going to be discussed about the adjustments and how they are going to use for the financial statement. So the name of this lesson, you can see the name of the lesson is adjustments for the financial statement. All of you have an idea about this financial statements. We discuss financial statements mean the final product of our accounting process, and there are two statements we discuss in O-levels. One is profit or loss statement, we used to calculate profit or loss for the period. Other one is statement of financial position. So let's see how these adjustments are going to make for the financial statements. When I come to the adjustments, first of all let's see the definition for these adjustments. Then you can see this adjustments definition is describing adjustments are the entries that are used to present the financial statement in more relevant and accurate figures. What is the meaning of this relevant and accurate? You can see I have highlighted them also. Relevant and accurate figures. When we make our financial statement, we have to make them exactly for the relevant accounting period. Accounting period refers to the 12 months period, 1 year period. So with these adjustments, what we are going to do, we are going to put our figures in our ledger accounts. We are going to make them to the relevant for the period value as well as accurate figures for the period. So these adjustments help you to represent the transactions, represent the ledger account figures in more relevant and accurate figures for the financial statement. So let's see what are the adjustments we want to discuss throughout our grade 11 syllabus. They are the adjustments we want to study through our syllabus. First one, we are going to discuss about accrued expense. Next one, we are going to discuss about accrued income. Another one word we are discussing with accrued income refers to the receivable income. Another two things we discuss in our classes, prepaid expenses and receipts in advance, but they are not in the syllabus now, new syllabus they are not going to discuss. Other one is bad debts. And the final one is depreciation. So throughout this video, I am going to explain you how these basic adjustments are going to be recorded to the financial statement with their respective double entries. So this becomes the first video, and the other video, let's make a big question. This video will help you to understand the theory part of this lesson. So let's go and check one by one how these adjustments are going to be discussed. I discuss here only four adjustments: accrued expenses, accrued income, bad debts and depreciation. So let's see one by one of these adjustments how they affected to the financial statement. Okay, let's start one by one adjustment. The first adjustment we are going to discuss is accrued expense. In other words, we can tell it as a payable expense. Here, this accrued word is a very special one, because if it comes with the expense, it becomes payable expense. But if you see this accrued word with income, it becomes receivable income. But this part we are discussing accrued expenses or payable expense. What is the meaning of this payable expense? Let's see the definition. The definition you can see here, the amount which is relevant for the current accounting period but not yet paid. So some amount won't pay for the period but not yet paid. period mean I told you 12 months period, 1 year period we consider as the accounting period. So the amount which is relevant for the current accounting period but not yet paid is considered as a payable expense. And it's very clear, anything become payable to the business, we recognize it as a liability. So this also same, when we concern this accrued expenses or payable expenses because not yet paid for the period, we can recognize it as a current liability for the period. So we are recognizing here, it is a current liability for the business. So what should be the double entry? It's very easy to understand because now already we have an idea, this payable expense is not the expense for the period, it's a liability. So when we go to the double entry, it's very easily we can build up the double entry. Relevant expense account will be debited and accrued expense account will be credited. So what the reason for this one? When there is accrued amount available, that amount won't be added to the paid expense for the period. So by debiting to the relevant expense account, we can increase the expense amount. Together with that one, that accrued amount should be considered as a current liability, so it should indicate with the credit part. That's why the double entry will come, relevant expense account debited, accrued expense account credited. And let's go and check about the example, how this is going to be recognized. This example, I gave easy example to understand for all of you. They told the rent expense for the period is 12,000 but only 10,000 was paid. So you can see the relevant amount for the period is 12,000 but only we paid 10,000. What is the meaning of this 10,000? This is the amount we paid in terms of cash. So now another one small thing I want to explain you, because we prepared our ledger account based on the cash basis. Cash basis means amount we paid in cash or amount we received in cash. But we prepare the financial statement on accrual basis. What is accrual basis? Mean relevant amount for the period. So here we only paid 10,000. That's why 10,000 only can be seen in the rent account. It means already we can see only 10,000 in our trial balance. That's why I record here rent account 10,000. So what's the normal double entry for this 10,000? Cash account credited already, rent account is debited already. But keep in memory, adjustment entries only want to keep for the adjustment amount. Another one thing, that adjustments won't be affected to two places. So here, what is the accrued amount for this example? 12,000 we want to pay, but only 10,000 we have paid, so another more 2,000 won't to be paid, or accrued. Therefore, we won't keep this accrued amount 2,000 to two places. What's the double entry? According to the X example, rent account won't to be debited, accrued rent account won't to be credited. Let's see how to record that one. Your rent account won't to be debited with 2,000 as well as accrued rent account won't be credited with 2,000. When we finalize this account, you can see finally total rent for the period automatically will come 10,000 plus 2,000, 12,000. So this is the amount to be recognized as the rent expense for the period. So it should be recorded to the profit or loss statement 12,000. But accrued amount for the period still available 2,000, that should be recognized as a current liability, so it should be recorded to the statement of financial position 2,000 as a current liability. I think all of you can have an idea about how to record the accrued expenses. Okay, then let's move to the next one. The next one I am going to explain is the accrued income or receivable income. Okay, let's start with the next adjustment. I'm going to explain you about the accrued income. According to syllabus, the word available is receivable income. But why I use this accrued income here? Because I want to explain the word called accrued. Some of our students misunderstand. They thought accrued mean payable. Not only that. Here accrued receive exactly accrued refers to receivable also. So what is mean by accrued income? It's also same like early definition. Accrued income refers to what? Let's see here with the adjustment. The amount which is relevant for the current accounting period but not yet received. It means same like the accrued expenses, but here it refers to accrued income, the amount bound to receive for the period but not yet received. We won't receive but not yet received. Then easy to understand, anything that receivable for you, won't receive but not yet receive, they become your assets. So it's easy to understand, this receivable income is a current assets for the business. And don't forget, accrued income or receivable income is a current assets for the business. So when we are going to develop the double entry for this one, it's very helpful to us because accrued income account is a asset account. So we want to keep the double entry for the accrued income based on this theory. What's the double entry for the accrued income we are recognizing here? Receivable income account debited. What the reason? Receivable income means accrued income, so it's a current asset to us. All of you know, asset, current asset should have a debit value. So asset account should have a debit value, that's why receivable income account will be debited. Together with that one, that amount won't to be added to the received income for the period. When income level increase, that should be credited. That's why we want to keep the other entry, relevant income account credited. So this is the double entry, receivable income account debited, relevant income account credited. You have an idea why we want to do like this kind of double entry. I explained to you, receivable income is a current asset, so it should have a debit entry. Relevant income account should be credited. Why? The income level won't be increased with the receivable amount. Okay, let's see the example. I gave an example. The investment income for the period is 60,000, but only 50,000 was received. So you can understand, amount which won't receive for the period is 60,000, but we have only received 50,000. So how much is the accrued amount? The 60,000 and 50,000 difference will be 10,000 not yet received. So you can see already we have recorded 50,000 in our investment income account. So this 50,000 now we can see in the trial balance, because already cash account debited than investment income account is occurred, because I told we prepared on cash basis. But now we are going to make adjustment how much another more need to be correct this investment income for the period. Another more 10,000 won't be come. So recall the memory of double entry. The double entry won't come according to this example. Investment income account won't be credited. Receivable investment income account won't be debited, because I want to increase the value of income by 10,000. And that 10,000 I want to recognize as a current asset in my statement of financial position. So let's see how can we do this transaction. Investment income account won't be credited 10,000. Receivable investment income account will be debited with 10,000. Finally, you can see the total value regarding to the investment income 60,000 to be recognized in the profit or loss statement. Together with that one, this 10,000 is going to be considered as a current assets in the statement of financial position. So this is the recorded part regarding to the receivable income. I think you can have an idea about how to record them to the ledger account and how can we record them to the financial statement regarding to the accrued income or receivable income. So let's go to the next adjustment and see how to recognize bad debts. Okay, let's start the next adjustment, that is bad debts. What is mean by bad debts? I gave another one word to you here, irrecoverable debt. So when we come to the definition of bad debts, we can easily understand the bad debts mean the amount which cannot be recovered from the trade debtors. Exactly what is the meaning of the bad debts? Because when we sold our stocks to our debtors, that's why we call them as trade debtors, because of some reason, that amount will not be able to recover from them. What are the reasons can be there? Death of the debtor, bankruptcy of the debtors, mental disorder of the debtor, like that various reasons can be caused to consider some amount as the bad debts. So the bad debts mean exactly what? The amount which cannot be recovered from the trade debtors. So when we think about this bad debts, it's easy to understand it is a loss to the business. We sold our goods but we cannot take money from them. So it is a loss to the business, therefore we consider this bad debt is an expense to the business. So here you can see, I told here it is an expense for the business. Based on that one, we can take a guideline for the double entry part. Because bad debt is an expense, so how can we develop the double entry for the bad debt? Bad debts account should be debited. Because it is an expense, we have to debit it to the bad debts account. And that amount should be deducted from the debtors. That amount should be deducted from the debtors, so the trade debtors account will be credited. So the double entry we can understand here, bad debts account debited and trade debtors account credited. What the reason? We already know that one, bad debts is a loss to the business, so it's concerned as expense. Expense account get a debit balance. Expenses increase should be debited. Because of the bad debts, the amount will be lost from the debtors, so that amount to be reduced from debtors. Debtors is an asset. Asset level decrease should be credited. That's why the final double entry we can develop here, bad debts account debited, trade debtors account credited. So I will show an example, then you will be easily understand how the bad debts is going to be recorded to the financial statement. Okay, let's go to the example and let's see. They told, a debtor with the value of 5,000 was decided to be write off as bad debts due to his sudden death. Now, because of the death of the debtor, we decided to remove that amount from his account. So already we have recognized this 5,000 as the credit sales item, because debtors will come to the business due to the credit sales. So already we have this debtors amount value 5,000. That amount can be seen as a debit balance in debtors account. This amount is the value that we can see in the trial balance in debtors account. But now what we are going to do, that amount is going to be reduced from debtors account. No longer that debtor is going to be paid money to us, as well as that amount is going to be recognized as an expense in the bad debts account. So as the double entry won't come, debtors account won't be credited, bad debts account won't be debited. Let's see how to record the transaction, how to record the adjustment into the ledger account. Bad debts account will be debited with 5,000 full value, as well as debtors account will be credited 5,000. So now you can see the debtors amount will be reduced by 5,000. Bad debts account is debited with 5,000. Finally, what we can see, this 5,000 is concerned as the value in the profit or loss statement as an expense. So regarding to this transaction, we have to generate an expense 5,000. We recognize this 5,000 in the profit or loss statement. That's why I told it's going to profit or loss statement. But when we are going to record them in the SOFP, statement of financial position, this bad debts amount should be reduced from full debtors amount and that net debtors value to be recognized in the statement of financial position. With the next video, I will explain you how to make that kind of complete question with the full adjustment part. Right. This is the bad debts complete part regarding the bad debts, and let's move to the next adjustment and let's see how to make that one. That is about the depreciation. Okay, our next adjustment is the depreciation. But this depreciation adjustment is a little bit big adjustment. So first let's see what is the definition for this depreciation, because depreciation refers to the going down value of a fixed assets due to the usage of fixed assets. You all know that one. Fixed assets refers to what? Assets which can be used for more than one accounting period. So when we are using that assets, the value of the assets will decline. The decline amount is considered as an expense to the business, that is considered as depreciation. But in your syllabus, we recognize easy things regarding this depreciation. We are only using straight line method for the depreciation. So according to that straight line method, we can take the depreciation is the distributing the depreciable amount of fixed assets over its useful lifetime. So according to straight line method, when we take the definition for depreciation, distributing the depreciable amount of fixed assets over its useful lifetime. Normally, we are depreciating only fixed assets. It should be more than one accounting period. And I told you earlier also, depreciation means that we are measuring the going down value for fixed assets over its useful lifetime. So according to this one, you can see I highlighted two words here. One is the depreciable amount, other one is the useful lifetime. So what is the meaning of this depreciable amount? I told you, basically we use two methods for this depreciation. One is straight line method, other one is reducing balance method. But here for your syllabus, we are only discussing straight line method. According to this straight line method, we always get equal or the same amount of value as the depreciation over its useful lifetime. The reason for that one is, I will show you what the reason for the equal value will come during the lifetime, useful lifetime, why we got the equal value for this depreciation amount. The reason is, we are going to do that one. We first of all calculate the depreciable amount. What is mean by depreciable amount according to this depreciation one? So I will move to the next one and show you that one. And already we discussed that one. Depreciation is an expense for the business. I told you they are regarding the fixed assets, but it's considered as an expense for the business. So when we discuss about depreciation, clearly we have to understand about what is this depreciable amount. What is the meaning of depreciable amount? When we take the cost of the assets, the amount we incur to buy the asset, cost, from that cost, when we reduce the scrap value, it's a new word to all of you. Scrap value means the value which can be sell the assets after its useful lifetime. It means, you know that one, when we purchase the fixed assets, we estimate the lifetime, the useful lifetime of the asset or the time period that we are going to use the asset. Example, we can take motor vehicle, we decided to use it for 5 years, like that. So from the cost, when you reduce the scrap value means after useful lifetime, the amount which can be obtained by realizing the assets, after selling the asset, how much we can obtain. After you get the difference, cost minus scrap value, that amount is called as the depreciable amount, because that is the amount to be depreciated throughout its lifetime. So how can we calculate depreciation according to straight line method? I told you this is a little bit big part, big adjustment. I have made a summary and show it to you to understand it easily for your calculation. So how to calculate the depreciation for the period? We call it as the annual depreciation. First of all, we want to concern about depreciable amount. It's equal cost minus scrap value or residual value. After deducting scrap value from the cost, the answer we can call as depreciable amount. Depreciable amount, that amount can be divided by the economic life or useful life. It means that is the expected period of the asset. Right? That is called as the expected period of the asset. So here, how to calculate the annual depreciation? Cost minus scrap value divided by useful life or economic life of the asset. So I think all of you can have an idea how to calculate the depreciation according to straight line method, how to calculate the annual depreciation. Always keep in memory about these two specific values, depreciable amount and annual depreciation value. But a lot of time we have to use percentage amount. Keep in memory, if they provide percentage amount, that percentage amount should be charged on the cost of the asset, because we should have a constant value. How to get that constant value? The provided percentage should be multiplied by the given cost of the asset. Later in the next video, I am going to show you how to make the depreciation one in the real financial statement part. Up to that one, I want to explain you as the theoretical part of this adjustment. This is the two values want to be concerned, depreciable amount and annual depreciation. So let's go and check that one, how the double entry can be kept for this depreciation. First I will show you a simple example, then you will be able to understand this example easily. Let's go and check the example. Okay, let's see the double entry of the depreciation. As I told you, this depreciation is an expense to the business, so always depreciation expense account won't be debited. Depreciation account won't be debited. And the other entry, we cannot at once reduce from the fixed assets. So we use a special account. This account is known as the contra asset account. I name it here accumulated depreciation. Keep in memory, accumulated depreciation, that accumulated depreciation account should be credited. So it's a little bit specialized double entry we have. Depreciation account debited, accumulated depreciation account credited. This is the double entry regarding to the depreciation. You will perfectly understand this double entry, how they are affected to the financial statement. With the next video, we are going to make a complete question with the adjustment. Now just keep in memory, the double entry is depreciation account debited because expenses level increase, accumulated depreciation account credited because it will reduce the fixed asset value. Directly we are not deducting from the fixed assets, we are deducting through a contra asset account called accumulated depreciation account. This is the double entry. Okay, let's see the double entry for the depreciation. There is a little bit specialized double entry available for this depreciation. As I told you, this depreciation is an expense to the business. So depreciation expense account won't be debited. Otherwise, depreciation account won't be debited because it will increase the expense of the business. Together with that one, that amount cannot be deducted directly from the fixed assets. Without doing like that, we are using a special account that is called accumulated depreciation account. So it is concerned as a contra asset account. So accumulated depreciation account won't be credited. So the complete double entry won't come. Depreciation account debited, accumulated depreciation account credited. So it's a little bit special double entry. You will perfectly understand this double entry, how they are affected to the financial statement with our next video. Let's make a complete question with this. Now just keep in your memory about double entry, depreciation account debited, accumulated depreciation account credited. This is the double entry regarding to the depreciation. So now I'm going to show you an example how to recognize the depreciation and how to record them to the ledger account. So this is the example what I provided to you. Let's see what are the provided details by them. Cost of a machine is 350,000. Scrap value is estimated 50,000. This scrap value is estimated amount, because scrap value means the value which is going to be realized after useful lifetime. And third one, useful lifetime is also estimation, is estimated as 4 years. So three figures they provided: cost, scrap value and useful life. Now it's very easy to calculate the depreciation based on the straight line method. When we recall the memory of the equation, annual depreciation is equal cost minus scrap value divided by useful economic lifetime. According to this question, I am going to apply the values. So cost is available 350, scrap value is available 50,000. I have reduced that one and divide by 4 will provide me annual depreciation. It means depreciation for the period. So let's apply the values like this one. Cost is 350,000, scrap value is 50,000, and the upside answer you can take it here 300,000. That is the depreciable amount, the amount which can be depreciated for the periods. Divide by lifetime is 4. Then 350,000 minus 50,000 divided by 4 will provide you 75,000. 75,000 is considered as annual depreciation. Now it's easily you can understand, if they provide this initial information, how to calculate the annual depreciation. It means going down value of fixed asset 1 year is 75,000. So let's go and check that one, how this 75,000 depreciation is going to be recorded in the ledger accounts. Using the previous double entry, let's go and check how can we record them to the ledger account. So I need two ledger account to be record this one. Based on the example, the annual depreciation is 75,000. And what are the two accounts I need here? Depreciation account and the other one, accumulated depreciation account. So what's the double entry? Double entry for this depreciation is depreciation account debitor, accumulated depreciation account creditor. So let's record the double entry here. Depreciation account won't be debited with 75,000. Accumulated depreciation account won't be credited with 75,000. And finally, special one want to understand. Regarding to this transaction, how much we recognize as the expense for the period, it should be 75,000. So we recognize this 75,000 in the profit or loss statement as a depreciation expense. And not to forget, I told you, this depreciation amount cannot be directly deducted from the assets. That's why we use this accumulated depreciation account. You can remember, in my statement of financial position, I want to indicate the correct value of my machine or fixed assets. So you can remember the cost of the machine is 350,000, but during this period, the value of machine will go down with 75,000. So when I am recording the value of machine in the statement of financial position, it should be 275,000. How this 275,000 come? From the cost, we reduce the depreciation in statement of financial position. So this is the method of recording depreciation to the ledger accounts. And I think you can have a perfect idea, exactly you can understand about really how they are going to apply to the financial statement with our next video. I think all of you will be able to get an idea about theory part regarding to the adjustments for the financial statement. And with the next video, I'm going to present you how to make the complete question using the adjustment what I explained with this video. And I think all of you got an idea about the basic adjustment theory part with this lesson. And so we thankful all of you for watching our video, as well as if you like to join with our online sessions, you also can join with them with the WhatsApp message to this number. When you can send them a WhatsApp message to this number, you also can join with our online sessions. As well as keep continuous contact with us, and throughout the videos, I'm going to explain you for the coming all lessons, and it will help you to expand your knowledge with this commerce subject. So thanks for all of you, and let's meet with the next video through the YouTube one.